The game plays right here.
Are you ready for some football?
Yeah! Your sports leader, WOHS Shelby, WLON Lincoln, WCSL Cherryville Gastonia.
Hello, this is Milton Baker inviting you to listen to NASCAR Racing right here on WCSL, 1590 AM, 92.3 FM, and KTCBroadcasting.com. And welcome to today's episode of Shock Jock Sports Podcast, presented by KTC Broadcasting. Hunter Yancey here. We have Kevin Hastings in the house, as always. We have Tom Cinefani back again twice this week. Tom, you just can't get enough of us.
Well, I'm just, it's like the playoffs, you know, when your relief pitcher, your save man has to come in three games in a row. So, yeah, no.
But so, Thomas, so like, is not a good time to use those
it's
words.
It's like, you know, you gotta come in, you know, we're all hands on deck this week. So, might help you out. This is weird. I was on a baseball field yesterday, Kevin.
I know. I got a text that confused the crap out of me.
Yeah, confused. I said a kid from, there's a left-hander from Weddington. And he hit two home, Hunter. He hit the first, either the first or the second pitch
of the game.
And it, he went opposite field. I don't think that ball's landed yet. Then he came up again, his second at bat, pulled one out of the park. I was like, well, who is this kid? And they said, well, he's going to Virginia Tech. And then the third time he came up, they had a lefty who didn't throw that hard, but he knew where to throw it. And I was talking to the catcher, and he struck him out on high and outside.
Yeah,
I said, you call that pitch? He said, yeah, I called it. I gave him the benefit of the doubt. I said, that just wasn't a miss. I said, that you called that pitch. I said, yeah. I said, it's up and away from where he likes it, but away from where he can't pull it. And he said, yeah. It seemed like it's always good to work with a good catcher, a smart catcher who knows how to call the game. So the one, you know, they're both Christian schools, but they were using some other kids that just hadn't had a chance to play. And, yeah, he was telling me about how he called pitches and things like that. I get into that because the better you understand, the better you are going to be as an umpire. Of course, they did get nailed. They got crossed up on the pitch location one time, and they called it outside. And, of course, it was on the inside part of the plate and nailed me right in the hand. So I was like, I'm back.
He can still catch it, though.
I'm back.
Tom said, I'm back.
He can still
catch it. This is all
I'm in pain. I'm in pain. I mean, it's like if I'm not in pain, I have an umpire.
You know, a lot of lefties can't hit high and outside. They have a natural.
He did.
They have a natural looping swing.
But
Jim Edmonds,
no.
King Griffey Jr., Barry Bonds. None of them. That's the hole in their.
The
swing.
Kid was a lefty.
Yeah.
So it was lefty on lefty.
Right.
So it was outside to the left-handed pitcher.
Right. High and outside to a lefty swing is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's usually the main hole. If you can get him to check Jim Edmonds, I can't count the number of times I've seen him swing at that and not come close to it. And Griffey, that was his spot. It was high and out.
Yeah.
Now, if you hang it high and out, they'll knock it out of the ballpark.
Yeah.
But if you hit your spot, that a lot of times that is the spot that they like. And then inside at the knees, that's the two spots that lefties do not like.
He wouldn't chase the inside.
Yeah.
But I gave him a hard time after the game. I saw him, you know, his mom was there, and I said, he got a little greedy on that one, didn't you? He started laughing. I said, you better watch out. He said, once they find that out, that's all you're going to see. Yes, it was good to see some, it was good baseball, you know, pretty good people over there. If I'm in pain and my feelings are hurt, I know I'm umpiring, but my feelings weren't really hurt yesterday. So
everybody was just happy to be back.
If anyone complains to the umpires at this point in time, they should be immediately removed from the stadium.
You'd be surprised.
What do you think, Hunter? Is that a new rule for
this year?
That's a good rule for
this year. That's the rule.
So if anyone complains at an umpire, referee, after months and months and months of no sports,
then Tom has every right to say, you're out of here.
Yeah. Automatic.
Well, you're out of here.
Tell you, everybody.
Fans. South Lake Christian is really a beautiful school.
It is.
It's really a beautiful school.
It's over towards Huntersville.
They have a very nice football and soccer facility with artificial turf, and they have very, very nice facilities over there.
Private schools usually have nice stuff like that. You know?
It depends on how established they are. You know what
they're
I mean?
Very established because I know for a long time their football program has always been top notch. They've always had a very successful football program over there.
Yeah, pretty good kids. Pretty good kids. One dropped an F-bomb as he was walking away.
That's sports. I think we all realize that. That's sports. If you don't realize that sometimes athletes do that, then...
I had a good conversation with the catcher about that. I heard the kid walking away, and, you know, he said, I heard him as he went away. He said, that's effing outside. And the catcher kind of laughed. I said, so you heard that? He goes, well, why didn't you say anything? I said, well, in this line of work, if a kid mutters something as he's walking away from you, you know, unless he screams it...
Unless he turns at you...
Yeah.
He didn't tell you were effing idiot. He said the ball was effing outside.
I'll say, what I do next time is like, all right, that's Six said that to me. Okay, so next time he comes up, I might dust off the plate. I said, hey, man, was that last one effing outside I called you out on? And usually they don't
was
say
was it a strikeout pitch?
Yeah, I rung him up.
Yeah, I'd have been like, well, the first two, you know, that's on you, boss.
Yeah.
Swing.
I rung him up, and what I usually do, and then I'll just tap that catcher maybe. Depends on the game. Okay, so, you know, you make this look good. I'm going to give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
And I call it, and then they get the message. You know what I mean? And then it's fine. Don't get stupid. You know, we'll call one at by. You know, the one guy was telling me a story about how he called one. Well, it was way up here, and I called. I said, well, you really can't do that. You sort of have to disguise it a little bit.
Right.
But they get the message that, you know, instead of being a jerk and throwing you out of the ball game, I'll give you a little message.
See, it's always been tough for me, especially, you know, I'm only six years removed from playing high school sports, obviously, so I can still remember. But they would always tell you, all right, guys, let's have a clean game out there. Let's show sportsmanship. Yeah. And it's like, we can do that, but don't get on us if our competitive nature kind of gets out of the way. This is sports at the end of the day. Like, I'm going to let a few ones rip. I got red carded one time, straight red carded, because I yelled the F word at one of my teammates because he let the ball go right through us. And he said, you're out of here. I was like, dude, what?
Yeah.
Are you serious? And my coach was just like, and just give me the finger, like, come here. And I was like, man, you're kidding. Yeah. You're kidding me.
I mean, 18-year-old boys. They'll be 18-year-old
boys. A good one for that, Tom, is also you can tell the catcher. Next time he comes back up, first pitch set up about a foot and a half outside.
and let
him throw the fastball right to you, and I'll call the strike.
And that's how you guys
just set up.
Like, and that one was outside, so I might have missed that one, but it felt like a strike.
Now, anybody that's listening right now thinking about hiring Tom for his next gig, look, we're not telling him he's going to do this, but these are just ideas.
That's a much better kind of under the table. You don't do it all the time. You don't do it all the time. And when you do something like that, it better be warranted. You don't do that all the time. But every now and again, you need to do that, which is much better than the problem with umpiring is you have the nuclear. You have a warning and the nuclear option. Like, you know, Hunter, you played soccer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The yellow card.
Yeah, the yellow card means you're on warning.
The yellow card, and there's a penalty. Like, you get to send him off. In football, all right, there's a penalty. But in baseball, there's not, well, he F-bombed you, okay, award a strike. You really don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
You have to either say, hey, son, don't do it again, which they're going to tell you in clinics not to do.
Or throw him out. Yeah.
So, I mean, you don't, and like, if you get a reputation for, okay, Tom comes to the ballpark looking to throw people out, then you're not going to umpire very long, because that's not why you umpire.
Mm-hmm.
But it's kind of one of those things is you sort of have to learn how to have a little bit of thick skin and not make a scene. And every once in a while say, yeah, kid, that might have been about 4 or 5 inches outside, but don't F-bomb me again. And usually right. that gets the message across.
It's just that, you know, it as a baseball player and umpire at some point, like, to me, you know, like I said, what about the first two strikes? And yeah. you looked at the third one, Chief. Like, yeah. it's not like you didn't hit the ball at all at that point. You're up here Mike Trouting it, hoping the pitcher walks you, swing the bat.
One kid asked me how far I was gonna call outside, and some umpires some umpires go with a 2-ball rule. And I don't really like that. I'd rather give the pitch a little bit up and over the plate. And a lot of umpires don't like to give the ball a little up and over the plate. But I'm gonna tell you, the big lefty took that ball that was up and over the plate and put it up and over the fence.
The batters a lot of times too, if they don't draw the freaking batter's boxes, they'll stand an inch away from the plate.
And I've told
a batter that dodged a pitch that caught the inside corner.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, you are standing on the plate.
Yeah.
Anything that doesn't hit you is a strike. Yeah. Like, honest to goodness, you're so close that anything that does not hit you is a strike. So expect the strike call.
And what those players do, and to speak on behalf of the player, they do that because, I mean, that the kid that he was standing on top of the plate, and I told him, I said, hey, kid, I'm just telling you, it's not illegal, but your elbow's over the plate.
Right.
And that's all I say. So he knows if that ball hits me, if it's out of the strike zone, it's a ball. It's going to stay here. If it's in the strike zone, which it could be in the strike zone, you call it a strike. And they know. So I try not to. He said, well, how far are you going to call that? Are you going to call it 2 balls out? I said, yeah, I try.
So funny to me. It's like, hey, man, look. Just give me an idea
where you're going to put this. Like, I've never been the batter. There's some people that do. They want to watch every pitch.
Look, I'm telling you.
It's funny because they'll say, I mean, some they'll swing at a pitch. They'll look back at me. Was that a strike? Or they'll say, is that the lowest you go? Is that the more cerebral batters who you probably are paying attention more, and you hope they're paying attention when they're not a bat. They'll ask you, okay, all right, how far are you going to go out? And I don't really want to say how far I'm going to go out because I'm not a machine. Mm-hmm. You know, right. Everybody says, oh, be consistent. Well, you know, sometimes it's tough to call the exact same thing. But once you go 2 balls, you know, you're starting to go that far. Now skill level, you know what I mean? If that pitcher, now they had a team, I can't remember where the kid was going to school, Campbell maybe, but he had – like high 70s, low 80s breaking ball. You can't give that kid that far off the plate if he's throwing that breaking ball around 80 miles at that particular skill level. You know, so
I would say there are a lot of umpires that don't know how to call the curveball.
Yeah,
as a pitcher, catcher, and a hitter at all three at some point, it's very aggravating.
Yeah.
Because some call it where the catcher catches it, some call it where it crosses the plate. Some of them, I don't even know if they know what they're doing.
See, but what I don't understand is like you've got, I mean, the zone,
right.
Give or take. So, I mean,
I call it nipples to knees, and it is what the way I call it.
That's all I've always been taught.
A lot of, now some of them, like I call the pitch around the navel, and some of them will look back at me and try to say, that's not a strike. I'm like, son. That's a strike.
I was taught growing up.
Pull the book out.
I was taught when I was growing up.
By the book,
it's
basically armpits, isn't it?
Below the armpits.
Right. I was just talking. So if there's anything at the belt's a strike. That's all I've ever been taught. I really think
it needs to be reevaluated. The book needs to be clearer. I think that it shouldn't say armpit. I think it should
say. What happened,
say,
Tom, is all these umpires started watching the Greg Maddux umpires back in the day, and that's it. And it get the zone. I remember it used to be high. It kept lower and lower and lower.
Yeah.
And then now you've got the guys arguing about balls at your freaking belt.
Yeah.
And I'm like.
Right.
If I'm a pitcher, what's my job? To keep it low so you don't knock it out of the park.
Right.
You not want the pitch high?
That's what I'm saying. Like I said, I know I keep going back to that left-handed kid, but the pitch that he drove out of the park twice was probably at his belt or at his navel. He's a big kid. He's probably 6'2" or 6'3".
I'm telling you, you ask any professional baseball player right now what pitch they really want to see is a high fastball because they're yanking the crap out of it.
That's why, you know, all levels of ball. You know, and some of the more, shall we say, cordial players will say, are you calling that pitch today? So, yeah, calling that pitch, I'm going to call it every day. But some of them then want a ball that's too.
Tom got sassy with him.
No, I don't. That's one thing is I try not to be hateful or like sassy. So, well, son, I'm calling that pitch today. Or I call that pitch every day. The pitch is a strike. But then they'll want, like a lot of them want a ball, a pitch called a strike that's maybe a ball or two below the knees. That's tough. Well, especially when you get a little bit more than a ball below the knees. That's, how are you going to hit that? I mean, no, if you, you do, you're going to ground out. So I try to make them bring it to the knees, and I try to call, try to get it, you know, to the navel somewhere around there and over the plate. Like you naturally, you're going to give a little off the plate. Now, pro umpires don't. I don't know if y'all have watched pro games lately. They don't. I mean, they don't give anything off
the
plate.
Well, they can't. They got the K zone.
Yeah, they don't.
Because they're judged and paid now.
But they are very good about.
And it's been about a year since I've seen a baseball game. So, yeah. I mean,
over the play. I mean, because I watch them. But what major league umpires have done is they have adjusted and started calling the pitch higher, which I like. Because what happens is exactly what you say is when you see it in the major leagues, then it starts coming down to the lower levels of ball.
Exactly.
Especially like, you know, what I hate are these damn double leg kicks they're doing and all this other crap they're doing from the windup.
Mm-hmm.
But if you, as you watch more major league games, I mean, Clevinger for Cleveland, he balks every freaking pitch and they don't call it on it. And the young guys, they watch this stuff.
Well, Thomas, the same thing.
And then the younger, then you got the coach yelling a ball to you every play.
Thomas, like, the same thing at the NBA level.
Same thing with the NBA level.
They take 3-4 steps before they even get to the basket,
it's
and there's
nuts.
Nothing called.
And then
the kids want to do it at the younger level.
In the 12 and 13 year old ball, when they're doing that, you just want to be like, coach, this is not that important, and he's not getting that big of an advantage to act like
that's
a fool.
That's crazy.
I mean, if you would, like.
To me, the Euro step is a walk.
It is.
It's a walk.
Well, they added a fourth step.
Yeah. It's crazy.
A gather step. Now, just think if they would have let Jordan have an extra step or Allen Iverson have an extra step.
Yeah, I know. But one time, Bob Knight, it's been a long time ago because Bob Knight was commentating. It might have been before he got the Texas Tech job. I remember it was a long time, but it kind of stood out in my memory that he showed a tall guy caught the ball on the block, and then he goes, watch his feet. 1, 2, like he was tap dancing. And he was saying that the travel needs to be called in basketball. And I've seen a lot of basketball games because I've worked the clock. Calling a travel is very, to be consistent on that can be difficult for an official. Right. But I think they need to get together and figure out what the heck a travel is. Mm-hmm. I don't think they have yet.
They basically let LeBron get his extra crab dribble so he could get around people. That's my opinion. But, if you really want to know my conspiracy opinion on it. All right,
Tom,
I got a list of things that we needed to get to today, and you can pick out one you want to talk about if you want. Here's my list of possible topics.
Let me just throw that out there before you get your topic. We probably won't get into this today. Did you guys watch the Armstrong documentary on ESPN?
No.
I think we went over this, but I did see the highlight where he was just screaming a bunch of fuck yous at the people.
Yeah, but I'm saying, you guys.
That was awesome.
But you guys.
He was just talking to the reporter, and he was just like, I was like, fuck you.
No. He said that's what people want to tell him.
Well, yeah.
See,
I would probably say
but
that,
you guys
too.
You need to watch that. It's good.
No, I didn't.
It's good. So I want to bring that for a topic sometime when you guys have time to sit down.
Yeah, but they don't.
That.
They're not reshowing it, are you? I'd have to get ESPN Plus to rewatch it because it's a 30 for 30. The only one that's coming up that's a 30 for 30 for me that I would actually sit down and watch. They're doing the Bruce Lee documentary.
I'm not gonna watch.
No, I got AT&T.
I would just search, and usually they'll have like reshowing. Just record it.
ESPN ain't showing in nothing else right now. So
yeah,
so
they'll probably do it. But I would recommend that one.
I wasn't on any of the Armstrong bandwagon, watched any of it. I'm not saying I knew he was doping, but I mean, first of all, it's bicycles. Like, to me, I was just like, okay, that's
for
neat.
For a while,
I mean, he won a bicycle
Lance
contest.
Armstrong could have been considered, you know, just at the Olympic and that type of competitiveness, Captain America at one point. You could have almost looked
at
him like that.
He was
all
so,
about that.
Mm-hmm. The thing about him.
The live strong.
Is he was so.
If you didn't have one of those wristbands when you were growing up.
He kind of encompassed what was so good and what was so bad in human beings all at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that's what makes him so fascinating to me.
Right.
Is he did so many good things. The live strong thing and all that. The way he beat cancer and he came back.
Yeah.
But then the way he lied. for years and years and years about what he had done.
But the,
in his defense, everybody else was doing it too.
And he held that kind of, until it came out, obviously, that he was lying and obviously was doping. He had that kind of Captain America feel to him, you know, the great story. Now, I mean, if you want to look just like on the Olympic level, who Captain America could be, it should always, to me and forever until it's beaten, should be Michael Phelps.
Yeah.
Michael Phelps on an Olympic level at that kind of competition, you know, if it's not a major ball sport, we could continue cycling, track and field, swimming. You want to talk about just an Olympic medalist because he's got 26, I think that was the number, gold medals.
Yeah.
It's kind of a stupid amount. Michael Phelps should still be Captain America, but that's what I thought of Lance Armstrong before it obviously came out that he was lying.
I see some parallels between him and Jordan, kind of the personality.
Probably the competitive nature.
The competitiveness. Like Michael Jordan wasn't real nice to everybody.
My thing about Michael Phelps and his gold medals, if they had 10 events for basketball players, how many gold medals would Michael Jordan have? We have a dunking event.
True.
We have a free throw event.
Probably.
We have a three-point contest event. We have 3-on-3. We have 5-on-5. We have reverse basketball, butterfly, underwater basketball.
Yeah, but you know it doesn't work like that, though. They're just, for him to be that great at so many different ways to swim
is ridiculous. I'm glad he's good at not drowning.
Yeah.
But he's not a hero to me because he doesn't drown.
He's not a hero to you because he got caught with a little bit of weed.
That's amazing to me. That was the most. That's more.
Didn't they
hero.
Catch him in South Carolina?
That's why that right there is the most impressive thing about anything he's ever done.
He got caught with weed.
Is that he is smoking anything and able to swim the way he does because of the lung capacity you need.
He's a big man.
While you're swimming,
dude, he's huge.
As swimmers are shaped very weird.
He is kind of
so are cyclists. Cyclists that have a weird shape to them. Yeah,
I guess it just depends on what muscles that you train the most.
Giant shoulders and skinny little bitty waist, and it's almost like the cartoon, like Johnny Bravo or something.
Yeah,
cartoon.
Yeah, Ryan Lochte. Ryan Lochte was a good swimmer too. He was just wild. He was like a young frat boy.
They all, you know, and one guy, the Europeans were like, well, the American cyclists, they were all weird. And why they were weird is because, like, if you're in America, you play baseball, you play soccer.
You don't
not soccer, you play football, you play baseball, you play basketball.
You can play soccer. It's okay, kids.
Yeah, if you're weird.
It's okay, kids. It's okay, kids.
And it did make a lot of sense because it does seem like those guys.
Oh, they were weird.
They're weird. But, you know, because they're not the typical word. Cycling's kind of a European thing. But anyway, Hunter, Kevin, I knew you had to
get it right.
I want to. He's been a punchy
he's
little bastard here lately.
He sits there real quiet, and as soon as the show starts, he just fires up.
He's sitting there real quiet.
The old hit and miss engine over here is Hunter. I'm scrolling down through some of the topics and issues of the day through the sports world, trying to pick out things here and there that I kind of wanted to hit on. All right, so I got a little small list of things, Hunter. I've got Calvin's favorite story in the news right now, and I think if this anything about this is true, that this would be his favorite story of all time.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go down a list of things I want to talk about. So looking at Duke, and is Zion Williams about to get them in a lot of trouble? Will he have to talk in court and testify? We've got NBA news. It looks like they're going to agree to a return here. We're going to talk about what we like, what we don't like. We've got Nashville. You see that? NASCAR is returning next season to Nashville.
I have not seen that.
Did not realize that.
So Nashville and NASCAR couldn't be a more perfect matchup.
Old Nash or Vegas.
Of partying and a good weekend and fans. So Nashville returning.
I might need them to take a trip.
Also on my list is Gronk lost the 24/7 title. So we've got to touch
it's
on
too
that.
Soon.
And I want to talk about Goff motorcycles. It's the best way I can describe that. So Hunter or Tom, either one of you want to venture down any of the paths first. We've got Duke and Zion Williams.
Tom, I don't know about you, but
NBA,
I want to get this one out of the way.
Nashville.
I have got to know about this golf motorcycle, and I just want to get this shenanigan out of the way.
I really didn't understand what he was talking about.
I don't quite understand either. Are we talking about riding motorcycles on a golf course?
He kind of speaks.
Is it kind of like polo with a golf club and a motorcycle.
That's okay. some kind of code he's speaking in.
No. It's literally golf and motorcycle put together, but I can't golf crack motorcycle. The code.
A golf motorcycle, you're right. It's as simple as that. I can't make it any more.
Yeah, but those two, code. They don't, what are you talking about? Instead of using golf carts?
Cart?
Yeah,
is,
I was going to say, instead of using a golf cart, they ride around on a motorcycle?
There we go. Join the fun here, Hunter.
No one else can see this.
I'm working on it. So,
the listeners
here you
online.
Go, Tom. This is the golf motorcycle.
I'm confused.
So with the coronavirus,
right.
They've been making people ride in single carts.
Mm-hmm.
And so a company has already developed these before this even happened. Look at it, Tom. Golf motorcycle.
That's actually really cool.
I know. It's an electric scooter.
Can I not just own one?
Yes, you can.
What?
I don't know why you couldn't. It's an electric scooter that holds a golf bag. Your feet go there at the bottom you're seeing. And you see the little back, the little flat platform?
Yeah, you
That's
stand.
Where you put your beer. That's where your beer slides into.
Should you be operating
motor-powered
equipment under
Tom. Your Yes, you could drive a golf cart.
I was going to say, they let me drive golf carts. Thank you very much. I had two tall boys with me last time I was out there. They were like, yeah, son, go right ahead.
You're old enough to drink, Hunter?
But it just
barely.
It just runs on the battery.
Barely.
And so some pros about it. It only weighs 75 pounds. And there
you can
are,
carry that.
Before this started, they were selling about to one golf course a month. They said the report, this is off Espen. The report off
Espen.
Of it is now this company is now getting one call a day and selling to one course a day. So they've went from basically 20 business days a month, so 20 times the business they have since this started.
As lighted as it is, too, golf courses probably wouldn't be as mad if you drive on the green.
That's what they, well, no, still no driving on the green.
Ah!
But that's what the golf course attendants are saying, and this guy right here is talking about, is that with it only 75 pounds, it's way, 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 way less than the cart. So really, you can go anywhere you want on them mm-hmm. and don't have to worry about the cart pass as much. A lot of the nicer courses, believe it or not, they don't have cart paths, and they make you drive in the fairway. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've ever been to a course like that, but every course I've ever
that's what I meant.
Played
a fairway,
over
$100-something
dollars. It's you driving in the fairway. They don't even have cart paths.
They still let it. Well, place I just went to had a cart path, yep. But they still let you get on the fairway if you had to go and get a ball. They're just like, eh.
Well, that's what they told us. A lot of places will say mm-hmm. if you go, they have the cart, and if you go out, stay out.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want you going because the rough is much more mushier and dirtier and stuff. So that's what you'll tear up is going back and forth through the rough.
Right.
So once you get on the fairway, it's a lot better. So this is they've had scooters, rideable carts, and scooters you just kind of stand on, and they've started with those. But what this story's talking about, it even mentions two courses that I've actually played down in Myrtle Beach, Caledonia and True Blue. And they're both down there near Pawleys Island. Caledonia is called the Caledonia Fish Club. I would say it may be the nicest course that I've ever played, and it's close to, I would mm-hmm. say, Augusta. As you could put something. Like, there is no flaws on that course, other than my game. I will say that.
Right.
We were down there. One time we played the course, and they were having a college women's college tournament down there. And it was the Gardner-Webb, whatever conference there,
yeah.
And that's who was down there. So there was some Gardner-Webb golfers there that come all the way from Shelby here, and we're down there golfing. They started on the one side, and they had the people that are regularly playing started on the other side, and so but we did get to see them, like, you know, warming up and putting and teeing off, and saw some of those girls. That course is outstanding. When you come in, it's nothing but oak trees on either side of the road.
Yeah.
So the road's covered in oak trees, and it's just as beautiful. It gets this right on the. It looks like the Everglades is where it looks at.
How much are they selling these for?
You know, we need to find that out. Why you trying to get one, Hunter?
I'm be honest. I'll just drive around my front yard. At this point, I need something to do.
Well, you can go buy a scooter if you want to buy a scooter.
Yeah, I know, but this is cooler.
How about when I was 13, I had the chicken pox? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Dad and the company had bought a scooter the summer before for remote broadcast just to ride around with the tiger suit on. How would you like to do that, Hunter?
Nope. Not with the tiger suit on.
Not with the tiger suit on.
Not in the summertime.
So I was quarantined with the chicken pox by myself mm-hmm. at home in the neighborhood.
Right.
When I started itching and getting tired, I brought the scooter home and drove it around the neighborhood. Infesting. I guess I infested the whole neighborhood with the pox. Ugh. But I felt good having the wind blow on them. But anyway, that's the my golf motorcycles for today. There's two different companies. This one's called...
See, Tom, we got it out of the way.
It's not really a motorcycle, though. It's a scooter.
This one's called Finn.
It is more of a golf scooter.
Finn Cycles. And then there's actually one that looks like an actual scooter. I'll pull that up in just a second. Let me switch over so you guys don't have to follow me while I search. Let me find the other company's name just to make sure. I'll show you. That one looks like an actual...
I'll tell you what.
A Vespa or something.
It's interesting. It's interesting.
It's different.
It's innovative.
It's different.
And I can see it catching on because
more
people...
Please don't tell me that. That's my idea.
I can't see a 75-year-old man using that.
No, not a 75-year-old man, but I could see, you know, while they're still implementing one person per cart, instead of just having, like, you got a group of four and everybody's out there in their own golf cart.
That's eventually got to go away. That's got to go away.
Eventually, but as of right now, Tom, it's not.
This one's called Fat Scooter, is what those guys are wearing driving right there.
Why didn't the golf course just do what my chiropractor did today?
What's that?
Take your temperature. No temperature. All right, you can ride together. You got a temperature, you got to go home.
Sounds like more fun, getting maybe a thermometer stuck up somewhere you don't want it or riding around on a scooter?
They don't stick a thermometer up. We're not 2 years old. They stick the thing to your head. What doctor have you
been to? Whoa, Tom, you don't have to be 2 years old for that anymore.
You can request it. You can request
Nobody does that anymore. Nobody. That's like 1970.
Tom, I don't know if you want to say that around my mother who's a nurse at a hospital that they don't do that anymore.
So this
might be if you're incapable. Well, they could just shine the thing on your head. Why do they need to do that? That's the craziest thing I've ever heard of.
I'm just saying, which sounds more fun? Are you going to a golf course to get medically examined, or do you just want to ride around on a little scooter?
It takes a second. They point the thing at your head.
The scooter sounds more fun.
No.
Yes.
Until somebody falls and puts it down.
My
wife said something about the, was talking about it. Or Andre said something as well about it's something kind of weird to give drunks as a motorcycle. Yeah. And my point was, I don't think they're going to mess them up as bad as they're going to mess themselves up. Because there's going to be a broken arm, a broken wrist.
Right.
That's where they're going to be messed up, because two dodos are going to be like, let's race. And
that right there was about 10 miles an hour on a bike.
You're right.
So can you see a drunk guy on a scooter?
These go 15 miles per hour, and that'll
be
on the grass.
Did you see a drunk guy on a bike?
Yes. Tom, all I got to say is, I guess you really did learn how to ride a bicycle. I never thought anybody could do that.
All I have to say is, Tom...
You forgot how to ride a bicycle.
If you're too scared, Tom, and don't want to be an American gladiator and warrior and want to get in your little cart, you can.
Well, I did.
Boys are going to ride the hogs.
I did finish the ride. I try to do somewhere between 8 and 11 miles.
You powered through?
Powered through, bloody and all, but I didn't, I usually stop somewhere and get a pineapple juice or something. My daughter says you got to drink some kind of fruit juice, keeps you hydrated. I just trust her advice. She said on the side. But anyway, I didn't stop because I didn't want to go in all bloody mess, you know, with the COVID and all this stuff going on.
They would have thought you would have got jumped. It'd been awkward having to say,
fell
off my bike.
I wasn't even going that fast.
These are called Fat Scooters. P-H-A-T, and they've got a page called Fat Golf.
How 90s is that?
P-H-A-T, Fat Golf.
Big old Fat Golf.
The original electric golf scooter is what they're saying here. But so, yeah, Tom, this is way more like a scooter. It's like it looks like the actual golf cart. With the
dude, that would be so fun.
With
Tom.
The thing on the back,
that'd be so fun.
I like the carts.
I didn't expect the poo pooing from Tommy on the golf motorcycles.
My God,
the golf scooters.
I thought you were hip.
The golf scooters.
I'm just traditional. I like that. There's nothing wrong with that. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Tom, are you that traditional?
You corona.
Tom, are you that traditional that you're gonna walk the course?
I have walked before. I do enjoy to walk and play.
I play better when I walk.
I do enjoy to walk.
It takes the buzz away too fast.
I don't drink and play because I like to enjoy the golf, and I don't want to.
Well, I enjoy it too.
Short game sucks, Hunter, because you're trashed when you're out there playing.
If I don't drink and I walk, I'll be all over par. If I drink, I'm add 5 to 10 strokes to it. Just go ahead and do it. So.
I never said I was trying to go pro.
I have to be to where I can enjoy it. Yeah. So, I mean, I just don't. I mean, I've seen guys get fallen over. there was one guy, my dad said they came to, my dad lives right at the 14th green and doesn't play golf.
Right.
Lives on a golf course, never played around a round of golf in his life. But he said the guys came by 14, they're pretty sauced up. And they came up and says, hey, man, what you got to drink in there? So he like, you know, dad's like, I got a couple of beers. So he goes in there, he says, gave him a few more beers and talked to him later, said, how'd they do? He says, well, on the 17th or 18th, the one guy went over to putt. And he like, just kept going.
Well, look, I will say this.
See, I can't play
now,
golf.
Now, look,
like
I don't always drink when I go out and play golf. But I will say this. When I'm not drinking and I'm playing golf, it might sound crazy, but I am a whole lot more competitive. So when I do drink, I'm a little bit more relaxed when I'm on the golf course. I guess because I'm not as focused, obviously.
I guess.
But I'm not as competitive, so I don't get as mad whenever I shank the shit out of my first drive.
I'll tell you, my brother, like, he's like quietly competitive because usually I can beat him.
Mm-hmm.
But the other day, I had a real bad day, and he beat me. And he's like all putting it all over, like texting all his friends and all that. Like, I'd go up to random people and say, hey, how you doing? Brother beat you in golf. I'm like, how'd you know he beat me in golf? Oh, yeah, he's texting. It's like, you know, but he doesn't, like, he doesn't talk trash like a Michael Jordan would on the course. But he's like, afterwards, it's like, well, how'd you know my brother beat me? Whoa, he was texting me on the 17th green, said you were doing awful. He was beating you. I was like,
those little golf, those things look so cool. If they were reasonably priced, I might have one shipped.
What are they getting for that? $8,000 or something?
I haven't clicked on it yet.
Here's something stupid that goes on in my brother's neighborhood because he does live in Riverbend, that they all have golf carts.
Right.
And not just like
tricked out golf carts.
Tricked out, mud tires, rims, stereo
thing.
Systems.
That people do that just as much as they do to their trucks.
$5,000 or $6,000 in a golf cart. Mm-hmm. You need new batteries. It's like $1,100.
Batteries are expensive.
Have you ever been to was it Ocean Lakes in Myrtle Beach?
I have, but it's been years. We camped. We actually had
that
line
that people do with their golf carts when they cruise the strip on there every night. Every single one of them about tricked out.
I'm telling you.
They got flashing LED lights, like stereo systems built in, like it's a subwoofer. And I'm like, my God.
I thought about doing the Ocean Lakes thing.
Yeah.
Until I saw what the homeowners deals were, dudes were. I'm like, nah.
Oh, no.
You're on the hook for $6,000 every year. It's like, no.
Yeah, it's expensive.
And you do not, the thing is you don't own the land either.
No,
you don't own the land.
No. Not at all.
But the thing is, Myrtle Beach owns the land and then leases it to Ocean Lakes, who then leases it to you.
They make a lot of money.
So what would make me nervous is like, okay, Myrtle Beach says, we're going to put hotels here. Well, what about my beach house? Well, you get to move it. I don't trust them.
Dude, these little golf cart motorcycle things, they look cool. They look cool, and I think they'd be pretty fun. I bet you they don't go. I bet they don't go like they probably go the same speed as a golf cart. There's no way they're gonna let some guy go out there and just absolutely tear up turf.
I mean, I know y'all like. Just give me the golf cart. You know what? I liked it, Hunter. It was a little funner when it was with three wheels because you could flip them easier. Because we did that when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Working out there with a little three wheel golf cart, you flip. You never see them anymore. If you see a three wheel golf cart, that thing's at least 40 years old. That made those since the early
80s. So, for all of you that have listened and watched so far, that was basically free advertising.
Oh, yes.
For golf carts.
Free advertising for golf
motorcycles
carts.
And golf scooters that they're trying to bring out.
Yeah.
Now, let me switch over to something that's a little bit more to do with actual sports, and it's actually developing news. It is, in fact, we're going to switch over to the NBA. That's right. They're trying to make a comeback. The NBA Board of Governors. I hate that they call them that now. I hate that they call themselves the Board of Governors. What's so wrong with being the owner of a team? Do you not own the team?
So you're saying it should be a Board of Owners is what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah, what are you talking about?
We have transitioned to the NBA.
Okay.
NBA.
I was just going to say, first of all, I always put this out there. I hate that they had they came to an agreement to call them the Board of Governors. But anyways, I'm going to say it this way. NBA owners, they intend to approve a league proposal tomorrow, 12:30 Eastern, is when the official voting will be for a 22-team format to restart the rest of the season in Orlando, Florida.
See, what I saw today was the 16-team proposal, and what they were doing, which was interesting to me, they were going to do the playoffs like the NFL does it. In other words, like if you're the 8 and you beat the 1, well, excuse me, you would be the 16 and you beat the 1. You'd still be the lowest seed.
Mm-hmm.
So if the second got through, you'd play the second. See, the NBA doesn't work like that.
Mm-mm.
See, if you're the 8 and you beat the 1, then you play the winner of the 4 or 5.
Well, this is what's been reported so far. NBA regular season return, 22 teams return to action, 13 Western Conference teams, 9 Eastern Conference teams. There will be 8 regular season games to finish out the season, I guess to help them get in play in shape before they just jump right into the playoffs. A possible play-in tournament for 8 seeds and playoffs, of course. They will vote tomorrow at 12:30. I had this pulled up originally where they had it kind of broken down. The play-in tournament is what it's a little question mark here around. The play-in tournament will include the number 8 and number 9 teams. If the 9th seed finishes the regular season within 4 games of the 8th. Sources said, in that case, the 8th seed enters a double elimination tournament and the 9th seed a single elimination tournament.
This is what I would do. Just do your 8 teams from each conference and share some of the revenue with the
teams.
This
isn't hard. Right. They're making
That's what I'm saying, because it's about money, Hunter, right? It's about money.
No, it's about trying to get Zion in the playoffs. Yeah. I have told you, because the team's currently within 6 games of an 8th place in the 2 conferences. The first one they listed is New Orleans. Portland, San Antonio, Sacramento, Phoenix, all of them Western Conference teams, and then Washington.
Yeah, well, Zion.
The lone Eastern Conference team.
Zion's going to need the extra money because he's got a few legal troubles.
Which we will get to.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute. I was reading about it, man. I'll let you go. You guys probably read a little bit more about me, but I think, Kevin and I think the same on this. Just do your 16 teams. I mean, just do your 16 teams.
I don't get it. I don't understand it.
Life in the NBA bubble will be governed by a set of safety protocols. Players and coaches will be allowed to golf or eat at outdoor restaurants. They will also need to maintain social distancing.
Well, that's
so that, the team can't go and golf together because you can't be in crowds larger than 10.
But we're going to rub up against each other on the basketball court in tank tops while we're sweating.
Two words. Two words that's going to get us out of this. Herd immunity. I don't know what else to say. You get sick, stay home, quarantine them.
Like, is this not the craziest virus ever, Tom? When if you're protesting or rioting, you're not contagious. But if you play basketball or if you want to go to a Republican convention, it is dangerous. So we can all stand beside each other and walk down the street, and depending on what your cause is, you're contagious and can trade the virus.
The way I see it is, Lowe's open, then everything should be open. That's all I
said.
If Lowe's open, then open up everything.
Employees at the Disney Resort has to do the same thing.
Well, with what's happened the past week, how can they tell us that us going to basketball games or football games or NASCAR races is any worse than the unsocial distancing that's happened this week? Well, whatever the cause is. But the fact, nobody's on TV talking about that now. They were talking about it when they were protesting the shutdown, when people were protesting shutdowns. They were talking about, look at these protesters out here spreading corona. And then now we're all over the country, and nobody's talking about it. So it's this whole situation with the sports is just, to me, it's been asinine, a lot of this stuff, because you tell, you know, we're going to shut down this program, we're not going to do this, and then we turn around and we're marching down the street. Like Cooper said, kicked out the RNC and then went and marched down the street with the, after he just said it's not. So
the basketball stuff is,
I thought basketball would be the last one.
But Cooper won't guarantee him they can have it. That's what he's saying. He won't come out and say, you can have it, don't worry about it. He keeps kind of dancing around it, saying, oh, we're not sure, we want to keep it.
I think they said last night and everything that it's you can't come at all now.
Trump said he's going to move it to Georgia, Florida, or Tennessee.
You know what? Why? Well, let me ask you: Because I do not know. Is the governor of South Carolina Republican?
McMaster? Oh hell yeah!
Okay.
He is.
Why don't they do? I know this is getting on a different topic, real quick.
No, I know.
Why
wouldn't
they, for fun? Because this is sports related. This is my comment.
Why not do the same thing the Panthers did and go to South Carolina,
Columbia? Yeah. How about Nash? How about a convention or whatever at the Myrtle Beach Speedway, where you can spread out everybody?
Technically, though, from politically speaking, you want to have your convention in a
swing state,
right?
That's 100%. Well, Obama did the same thing in North Carolina.
I mean, that's
Trump
a strategy.
The same thing.
To me,
100% get it.
This is mine because I teach politics. The convention is kind of like summer break in school. It's outdated. You're hanging on to it because it's a tradition.
Mm-hmm.
You've got enough media exposure. Back in the days of the brokered convention, it made sense. Like you take a James A. Garfield in 1880 who comes out of nowhere because the convention got into smoke-filled room and he emerges as the candidate because All the other ones
they didn't have internet and TV and stuff.
Right, right. But now we have the primary system where we already know it's Biden. We already know it's Trump.
Right.
Why do we need the convention? It's left over. It's a relic. Why is it still here? I mean, move forward. We don't need it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you got rid of the primaries,
mm-hmm.
bring back the smoke film room and figure it out. Now, there, I know there's always a small chance there might, but it's not worth
right.
it. It's something that most Americans don't really understand anymore. You get all the media attention you want. How many 24-hour news networks are there? I could see maybe right. if we go back to 1980, mm-hmm. okay, you still need it because you don't have that many media outlets. Good Lord. You got Fox, you got MSNBC, CNN, whatever you want, Rush Radio. The time we've moved beyond. We don't need this convention to learn about the candidates.
All right, Hunter, go over for one real quick one more time. Another mm-hmm. Description basically of what the NBA is going to do, so I can break down some
okay.
of my opinions.
We'll start and just with the basis of it.
Okay.
22 teams. I'm fine with it.
I'm not.
I'm fine with it. I'm okay with with the bottom feeders not having to be
it
in there.
It should be either 30 or 16.
Play like, them all, exactly.
Why are we giving these guys extra chances? For example, did you say 9? In the East, in Washington,
13 in the West, 9 in the East. So you're only adding one extra in the East outside of your top 8.
So here's
out of the playoff picture.
Here's why that's weird for me on this point. Okay,
well, if it plays out, I'm just saying you would end up probably having like how I said it would end up more teams making the playoffs from the West than the East. There would no longer be 8 and 8.
Are they going to go? Is
because
the
top 16 is 100%.
Yeah, yes, they're doing top 16.
Oh, okay. So they're not going to split East
It's not
going
to be 8 and 8. No, it's top 16.
So they're just making,
there has been nothing mentioned
it,
about
so
East and West.
Even more dumber. As
so you're talking like a town that has a lousy Shit. Basketball team like a Cleveland.
Mm-hmm.
So you basically told them, okay, you've just basically told all their restaurants and outdoor all that, sorry, you don't get to have a game. Mm-hmm. I know they're not going to sell out. But if, like,
well,
the Lakers or somebody
this
came
This is all in Orlando.
Because I'm telling you, I've read
oh,
it.
Oh, that's remember, right. That's
it's
right.
All,
that's
yeah, it's
okay.
all
that's
in Orlando.
Okay.
It's
no
all
travel.
In Orlando.
So
and everything everything I'm reading.
No fans, no travel. Okay. No
everything
nothing.
I'm reading, nothing says East-West.
Okay.
It's just top 16.
Okay. Well, if that's
okay.
the case.
That makes more sense.
That's
okay.
dumb. That's even dumber than dumb shit. I'm so tired. Why can't, again, Tom, why can't we just play the 16?
That's what I'm in favor of.
We're already, you know, the East-West, they've played it all year.
Mm-hmm.
Just do the – they don't have to change a thing. They just say, hey, guys, we're going to play the playoffs in 2 weeks. They don't have to do anything. But instead, we're adding these 22 teams so we can warm up. Now, let's go to that ninth. I do want to talk about that. So we've played 64 to 66 games depending on which team you are. Okay, so let's say 65 games. On average, means you got 17 games left in the season. Are you telling me the Washington Wizards at 16 games under 500 – have been slow playing this to suddenly, hey,
listen,
last 18 games,
this.
We're going to turn it on,
I can
boys.
Tell you this. They're not a playoff team at all, whether or not they were an 8 seed or not. They'd get blown out in the first round. So I can promise you this. I definitely don't want to see any more. And I'm a Wizards fan. As long as we don't have a full-strength roster and we're still slowly rebuilding, they won't admit it, but they're rebuilding, I don't want to see them.
Yeah,
I don't want to see them.
My opinion.
So part of me is okay with them. Just doing top 16 and leaving some of the teams out of the East out. I don't want to see Orlando if I can see a better team out from the West.
How did they draw the line? It is what I want to. How did you draw the line of Washington gets in? Because I'm gonna read you some of the folks around Washington. Again, they're 16 games under 500,
and they're not qualifying for the playoffs right now.
They're ninth. Right, they're ninth right now in the East.
Yeah,
10th in the East is the Hornets. So they drew a line, Hunter, and said if you're 16 games under 500, you get to play. The Hornets are one game behind the Wizards. So what meeting did we have that said, you know what, I bet these Wizards could make a run, but the damn Hornets ain't going to.
Well,
they're
see,
only one game out.
Because you make a good point, because if you've already set in stone you're going to bring 22 teams back, why would you not just go 11-11, East and West? You're 11 teams in the East, 11 teams in the West. But instead, you're going to have 13-9.
They just decided to take the top 22 teams? Is that what they're doing?
I'm telling you exactly why they did it. And it's because, you know, I heard it from Colin, and it makes 110%. They want Zion to have an opportunity to make the playoffs. Zion is not sitting at the 8th spot. Hey, he is tied with multiple people fighting for the eighth or ninth spot.
So Washington is the 22nd team in the standings, and the Hornets are 23rd.
Yeah.
So the top 20, they're taking the top 22 teams. I don't know where they got that number from or why that's fair. Did they say how many games are going to play?
Eight.
So let me count up.
Eight regular season games, and then
those teams can't even make the playoffs, some of them. Like, Wizards have no chance of even making the playoffs. 3, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let me count them up real quick. 3, 6, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So right now, the Wizards are currently 5.5 games out of the 16th spot with 8 games to play. Come on, NBA.
Yeah. So if you take the top 16 right now, Orlando would be sitting at 16.
That means they have to go 8.
You know who's 17? You know who's 17 and 18 now right now? 17 and 18 fighting for that 16 spot due to how they've set this up right now. 17, Portland.
Yep.
18, Zion and New Orleans. I'm telling you, because think about it. Which is going to be a bigger draw? Orlando or Damian Lillard, CJ McCollum in Portland, or Zion and all the ex-Lakers that might draw the Lakers as their first overall game out of New Orleans?
I would give anything.
I'm telling you, man.
I would give anything for the Durantula to come back. I would give anything.
He's not.
No.
They've already said no. He's not.
And I don't think Kyrie would have come back either because he shut it down and had surgery.
If them two came back, this would be a whole different.
They're not.
It'd be a whole different ballgame because,
they're out of the bottom.
They'd be the 15 seed, and just if they went 1-16,
they get 50, the Lakers in round one.
They get the Lakers in round one. That'd be two. That'd be a 2-15 matchup.
It would be LeBron Durant in round one.
Yeah, they're not going to do it though. I was hoping he was going to come back too, just to go ahead and put LeBron out. But you know, and I like LeBron, but you know, if he would have went anywhere else besides Los Angeles, he went to the Lakers. Yeah, you know, if he would have gone to somewhere else like a.
What's like weird about him wanting to be the greatest, Tom? He wants to be named it. Obviously, he talks about it. He calls himself that. Is that if you want to be something different than Michael, why do you wear 23? Everything he's done has been a fuck you to Michael.
But he wore 6 in it, Miami, didn't he?
Right. Yeah. You know why? 23 is retired in Miami.
Did not even realize.
The Miami Heat retired Michael Jordan's number.
Mm-hmm.
So Michael Jordan's number is retired in Miami and LeBron's is not.
Did not
they
know
have
that.
They have championship banners delivered by LeBron.
And they have Dwayne.
And Michael Jordan's number is retired.
And they have Dwayne Wade's number right next to him, too. What's that? Another thing that drove me absolutely bonkers today when I was driving in, so I was listening to Colin's show, because, I mean, it's on when I'm on my way here, and I like listening to it.
Why does he always make an excuse for listening to Colin? Like, every time he mentions it, he makes an excuse.
And this is the thing, is because a lot of people...
He's promoting another
sports
show.
A lot of people would probably say that you get a lot of your opinions from Colin. And it's like, no, that's just who, you know... Who you listen to, you're going to hear their opinion, and then you can make your own assumption. And basically what he was saying is that this is what he said, and I hated every second of it. He said, the NBA needs LeBron in the finals. I said, what the hell do you mean they need LeBron in the finals? Act like there's not a more polarizing narrative that can be written. If Giannis makes the finals with small market Milwaukee and wins it, maybe Kawhi Leonard possibly getting Paul George's first championship out of the Clippers.
I think the
fact that people think
the Clippers
the NBA
have never been to
is
conference final.
I think they want because Los Angeles is more than just the LA market.
They
there
want
LA
it. They want it because this would be the year to in memory of Kobe.
Again, think about LeBron.
That also fits.
Again, I want to go back to LeBron's career. Yet. Think about that happened this year.
That's what I'm saying. 2020 has been
it's
shitty.
Been so long that happened this year.
Yeah, I know.
So let's think about that. I just don't like
the fact that, like, the major media people, they all think the NBA is driven by LeBron. LeBron wasn't in the finals last year, and I had just as much fun watching the Warriors play against the Toronto Raptors.
So before Chicago, before Michael got there and won a championship, that franchise didn't win nothing. It was garbage. So he put the Bulls on the map. They haven't won anything since. So let's talk about, real quick, LeBron. You said he wears 23. And so if you want to be better than somebody, you want to be them, why would you wear their number? I don't mm-hmm. get it. Why would you not make a legacy in your own
number?
It's almost a personal attack on him because I'm going to wear your number. I'm trying to make that number. Because think about it. Say LeBron was the greatest and Michael was the second best ever. Then you couldn't say, well, who's the best number 23? Sankey, he don't even get that, and he's the second best player. So come on. So he does that to be a jackwagon. Now he goes to L.A. Under what circumstance, and people are already putting him on as one of the greatest Lakers ever, for doing what? You haven't made the playoffs yet. You're going to get in now.
Mm-hmm.
But you still haven't won a playoff game. What'd Kareem do? Magic won 5 titles in L.A. Kareem's the all-time leading scorer. Kobe won 5. Shaq won 3. And so at what point are we going to be – what can he do in L.A. that would put him on the map with all those that won at least 3 championships? Is he going to win one like he did in Cleveland and say, now I'm the greatest Laker ever because I brought a championship back to L.A.? Because that's what he said in Cleveland. He's like, I'm the greatest ever because I won in Cleveland. What about Chicago? They didn't win nothing until he was there.
And guess what?
Until Michael was
there.
They
haven't won anything after.
Yeah. It's just weird to me. Like, his whole legacy is that your number's not even retired. Michael Jordan's number's retired in Miami where you won your championships. Mm-hmm. You go to L.A., you'll never be the greatest Laker at all at any point. So what is your legacy? You got to go all the way back to Cleveland, which you left twice. And I'm sure they love you for all of that. So it's just a weird, weird, like, where's his fans? Is it just LeBron fans? Is that what it is now?
There are a lot of LeBron fans. There are, because wherever LeBron plays, that's where I pull. And that's fine. I mean, that's just the way
people have more connection to players than teams.
Yeah, people
now
do have that connection to players, and fantasy basketball and football has done that. But, like I said, I just have a hard time pulling for him or the Lakers. It would not hurt my feelings to see him put out in the first round. I don't think they have.
It won't hurt my feelings at all. So we're kind of hit and miss on how we feel about the 2022 teams being the return. Y'all don't like it. I don't care.
I'm fine
with it. But if that's the case and you don't like that they're even returning that many teams, then you probably don't like the 8 regular season games that they're going to play.
No.
Okay.
I think
what
they
do you
just
think about the play-in tournament then for the 8th seed?
No. Not necessary. Just go with the top.
Keeps getting dumber and dumber. They keep making up. Why are we making up stuff and just instead of just playing
this
the
is
system?
A,
I'm just
and saying. The thing is, this is a one-year thing.
Right. I'm just saying.
This is 1 year. This is never going to happen again.
So if you make some janky playoffs, and now watch this, they'll make up some wild things. So let's say this. All right, so we're going to make the playoffs where LeBron's not going to have to go through the toughest teams, is what they're doing. Think about it.
Yeah.
If he's in the West, he has to beat probably at least 2 good teams to get to the finals. If you flip it around and go 1 through 16 seeds,
he doesn't have to.
He didn't have to beat anybody.
Because he gets to play the lowest.
Right.
Yeah.
He plays the lowest
seed will play
every
whatever
time.
The lowest teams
or the
are.
Second lowest. They're
the second
two.
Lowest. Right.
It doesn't matter. They're still the lowest. Anybody that's below 8 is nothing.
So yeah. it's they're giving them basically two round passes right now. And the Hornets and Clippers have never gotten out of the second
You're
round.
You're 8 seed right
and they're
now.
Automatically giving it to the Lakers. And you're going to tell me there's not going to be no asterisks on this season when you just make up whatever playoffs?
Because let me tell you this. Anybody that's underneath the 8 seed, because if you know we just talked about it, they're going to draw the lowest seed all the way up. Right. Doesn't matter. Like anything
like football,
below 8.
Like football does.
The 8 seed right now is Miami. Miami can be tough. But do I see them winning a championship? No. Below them, Oklahoma City, not winning a championship. Houston. They could be a mismatch.
They are dangerous. That is,
but
that,
I'm not.
That's who
but,
the Lakers
but I don't, but
do
I don't see
want.
Them winning a championship.
I don't think
they would even see Houston. I think Houston would get
what
put out
phrase,
before
the
that.
Phrase I was reading today that said Houston is allergic to defense.
Yeah, they are.
I mean, they don't play.
And it's D'Antoni's fault.
And here's my thing about Houston.
What's that?
It's D'Antoni's fault. It's offensive minded.
I know they can't. I know they can't. Won't play defense. I know they're not going to win a championship. But if the Lakers got them in the first or second round, the Lakers cannot guard them. I know.
You would have to
and
catch
I know
them,
that team could knock them out.
So then after Houston, Pacers. In the East, they probably would have made some noise. Now that it's 1 through 16, no.
I don't have
Philadelphia, no. They are dysfunctional. They don't know who's the man.
They should be.
The Mavericks. The Mavericks are rising. Not there yet. Memphis, rising. Not there yet. Brooklyn, no KD, no Kyrie, no Winnie. I'm sorry. And then Orlando. Man. So outs everybody that's technically 7 up. Yeah. Maybe. Because Utah will pose a threat. That's another Western Conference team. Denver, I think, is undersold for a West
Don't
Coast team.
Don't forget about Toronto either.
Toronto actually would be the 3.
Best defensive team.
Yeah,
in the
they're the 3 seed.
Yeah.
Toronto's the 3
they
seed.
They lost Kawhi and they're still 3 seed.
They're still good.
Best defensive team in the league.
One of these days.
Your top, technically your top four seeds, if they don't go east-west, is Milwaukee, L.A., Toronto, and the Clippers. But if they went east-west, it would be Boston, Toronto, Milwaukee, and the Lakers.
What does Kyle Lowry got to do to get some...
get some love?
Yeah. He consistently wins.
I think they...
It is nonstop winning from that kid.
He's just
some of his pouting.
It's because he's fat.
Because he's fat.
It's because he's fat.
No, because he pouted a little bit.
He doesn't dunk.
He's kind of fat. That's exactly what it is. He's not flashy. And everybody loves the flashy point guard right now.
But they don't lose.
Well, here's the thing.
They've been good for... That's been a good organization for a long time.
So I have told you how it is, and I have told you how they're going to line it up, and they're voting on this tomorrow at 12:30, and guess what? It's probably going to get passed. So now the question just comes down to, you have to pick it right now. We'll just go straight 1 through 16. Who's here now? Who's winning the championship?
Clippers.
Clippers? That's who I would have taken. I would have taken the Clippers.
Yeah, I was looking at the rosters today just out of curiosity. Lakers roster and Clippers roster.
The Clippers roster is better.
Deeper.
It is deeper.
I think they're deeper.
The Lakers are older.
There's...
And all of them are on one-year contracts. This team's going to blow up next year for the Lakers.
Yeah, I can't remember their center's name. He's a real
Dwight
journeyman.
Dwight and JaVale McGee. JaVale McGee.
Yeah, McGee was with the Warriors. He's kind of a journeyman.
That's all he's
been. Anthony Davis under 30, you'll win every game. If he gets over 30,
because nobody
be a
else
game.
Can score 30,
it's gonna be a tough game. Like, who else is gonna get there?
If you let Anthony Davis score 25, LeBron get his 30, and then maybe like an Avery Bradley or one of their 3-point shooters get 20, they will be hard to beat. But
they've got another guy that comes off the bench.
Tom's running again. I know.
They look at their roster. They got another guy that comes out because I've seen him play. He's pretty good.
You're talking about Kyle Kuzma.
Yeah, that's him.
Yeah, Kuzma. He's the youngest player on the team. He's been there for like 3 years.
He's pretty good, though.
He is good.
He's pretty good.
Kyle Kuzma is very good. I pushed that the Hornets at the trade deadline should have moved a player for him because they need wing scoring, and that's what he can bring is wing scoring. They should have traded Rozier or somebody over there. Just they needed wing scoring. But I'm looking at this, and one narrative that I think a lot of people forget is because they always want to talk about, LeBron, obviously. They can't get LeBron's manhood out of their mouth. Seriously, they just can't. They can't. And they talk about how this could be his third team he wins a championship with. Did we forget Kawhi Leonard is in the same boat? Kawhi Leonard won a championship with the Spurs, carried the Toronto Raptors, and has an opportunity to win two championships, really, in back-to-back years with separate teams, so he had to learn a whole new system. He's got more help, I think, here than in Toronto, but it's his third championship, too, with a different team. Yeah. So when do we start throwing Kawhi Leonard on a pantheon of greats?
Well, the last 6 years, Toronto has finished third, fourth, second, third, first, and second.
They've always been
in the
good.
East.
They've been good. They've got a good
six
organization.
6 straight years. Larry got there in 2011. They went 14th, 11th, and 10th, and then after the 13th season, starting in 14, that was when he turned 27 years old, they started winning every year then. I'm trying to find a particular stat or something that shows, man, that's the jump they made.
Philadelphia's the team that should be good that's not. You know what I mean? You look at them, they got Simmons, they got Embiid.
That's the old scouts what's it called? Your fantasy basketball. Mm-hmm. If I put all my 6'9" guys out there, I should beat all of you. Type of thing, as opposed to chemistry and stuff on the court. And one thing on the basketball court, it's more important about anything, is that you need the star. You need the two stars, right?
Uh huh.
But everybody else on the team has got to do what they're supposed to do and do their roles. And that's the key that. Some teams don't win. At the Rockets with Barkley and Pippen when they were old, they still had Drexler and Olajuwon. There's no reason they shouldn't have been competing or almost winning.
Just
with
didn't
those
work.
Guys.
Just
if
didn't
you
work.
If you put it on paper, how about Karl Malone and Gary Payton going to the Lakers, joining Kobe and Shaq, and they didn't. Or Kobe and Paul, and those guys that didn't win then. The chemistry thing is really important. That's why I say about the Lakers, while they're beatable, is that if you hold Anthony Davis under 30, 35, anywhere under that, then they're going to have tough getting to and staying there 100. If you're running LeBron at point guard, now he's wasting energy and doing things that he shouldn't be doing. And that's the whole thing on this, the whole passing to the corner thing. Do you want LeBron running point guard and looking for Danny Green to score, or do you want someone else playing point guard and looking for LeBron to score? And that's the Lakers worrying about that. I think the Raptors, they wouldn't. I think they match up well with Milwaukee. I mean, Pascal Siakam is going. He would D up and play with Giannis on that part. I don't think they don't have someone that can give them hell. And they
personally,
got Lowry.
Personally, I think this makes the playoffs the most interesting it's been in years. That's just me, but that's just because for years until LeBron went out west, it's been that's because we've been used to has been Golden State and LeBron. That's it. That's all we've known for almost 4 years now. So now I'm interested. That's why last year I loved it. It was, sure, it was Golden State, but it was Toronto. You know, I have LeBron fatigue to a max. Okay, I'm so tired of LeBron. I can appreciate his greatness, but I'm so tired of just ESPN LeBron this, LeBron that, LeBron's in the finals, yada, yada, yada. I like parity, and I feel like this playoff system is going to have that to a degree. Sure, we're still going to count both of the Los Angeles teams to be the favorites to at least get there if you did West versus East. But out of the East, Milwaukee, Toronto, Boston could even have a shot. Boston's got playmakers all over the court.
Right.
So I think this makes it more wide open. Just, I agree with what Kevin said. This is if you have it this way and the Lakers start clicking, this is a cakewalk for LeBron. This is just as much of a cakewalk than the East. Because all he's going to do is always play the lower seed. And so that's all he'll ever, between the two teams that I've already played. So I'm just excited for it.
You know,
I have the dates here
in the
somewhere.
Playoffs. You know what I'm ready to see in the playoffs? Because he'll get the arena jumping.
Who?
Luka Doncic.
Yeah, I think.
He gets hot in a playoff series. Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness.
I was upset the one time I went to Charlotte to see Dallas.
He didn't play. Neither him or Kristaps played.
Neither one of them played. A little upset about that.
We got to see Boban, the biggest man alive.
He is huge and a clown. Yeah, that's a funny. I mean, he's just a clown. He's having a good time.
Then I just have the final details for it. 22-team format. Season's proposed resumption would be July 31st. Timeline shared with teams. The last possible date for a finals game would be October 12th. So July to October.
That's too long.
That is because, and then not only that, then they're talking about starting the season right back up Christmas, December.
They would have a little bit of
why
a
would
lag.
It take so long? Mm-hmm.
Okay. I don't know why it takes so long. Cut down the first round back to 5-game series?
I'm all for that.
So they're going to play 8 games. If you play 2 a week, that's a month. So you play 1 month in July.
I'd say if
and then you have August and September to play the playoffs.
Are they worried about the guys being in shape, right? Just play 5 games until the finals and play 7. You see what I mean? This is a 1-year thing. That's what I keep saying. It's a 1-year thing.
In my mind, it shouldn't take that long because you don't have travel restraints. You can play every night.
But they're not going to play every night.
No, there'll be too many teams, so they won't. Here's the the worldwide of ESPN down in Orlando, they have to have multiple basketball rings.
They
will be able to play every other night, though. That's going to be the key. They play back-to-back nights in the playoffs sometimes, and they changed it to where you skip a day now when you're at home, but now there's no reason to skip more than one day, I don't think. And I mean, you're not going anywhere, like you said. Any other notes on that? Anybody got any other comments?
No. I guess we'll talk more about it because all we're talking about is what they might do.
Right.
Let's see what they do.
That's what sucked the last few months is all we do is talk about
what they might do.
We just speculate.
That's what it is.
All right.
That's all we can talk about.
Zion Williamson, Florida State judge on Tuesday denied his request to stay discovery into whether he was eligible under NCAA rules when he played at Duke. Florida 11th Circuit Court judge ruled that Williamson will be required to answer interrogatories and requests for admissions from attorneys representing Gina Ford, Prime Sports Marketing, who are suing Williamson for $100 million for breaching their marketing.
He's going to have to use some of that money to get a lawyer.
Right.
I think he's already got one.
Yeah.
Because they're fighting this in North Carolina, too. That's the claim that his lawyers are making.
They're claiming that two of its employers alleging that CAA interfered with Prime Sports' deal with Williamson and that he breached their 5-year contract. Last month, 4 attorneys asked Williamson to admit that his mother and stepfather demanded and received gifts, money, and other benefits from persons acting on behalf of Adidas and Nike and also from people with Duke to influence them to sign with the Blue Devils.
Mm-hmm.
The issue is a complete Canard and red herring, Williams' attorney said.
When anybody calls something a red herring, you know they're lying.
Yeah, is that Tom? Tom's
You're
lying.
Trying to use this dramatic language.
Yeah, Williamson's attorneys, they're expected to file an appeal with Florida because they're arguing an earlier federal case in North Carolina involving the same parties and claims has precedence. So essentially, what's getting brought to light is something that's already ongoing in North Carolina, just we're just now hearing about it.
Wait, here's the thing. See, this isn't in no kangaroo state court. This is in federal court.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a big difference that it's in federal court. You know, you can get away with something in state court, COJ Simpson. The feds
me
don't play.
I'm just telling you, the feds don't play. Me and Kevin, before you came in, I read Kevin this statement, and it raised both of our eyebrows. Stephen A. Smith, if Zion has to testify, Duke may have a problem. Now, if that doesn't scream, Stephen A. might know a little something.
He knows.
He has to know.
He knows some stuff.
And here's the crazy thing. We've all thought it. How the hell did they land the top three recruits in the same recruiting class? We've all thought it. It's just now coming to fruition. Because I promise you this. When I heard the story, I know I talked about it maybe a few podcasts ago. When I heard the story that Bill Self in Kansas offered him $100,000 and he didn't take it because he wanted housing for his family, I said, well, then how'd you end up at Duke? I know it's not as far of a drive if your family just wants to come and watch you from South Carolina, but you just turned down $100,000.
I'm just going to tell you that I think Krzyzewski sold his soul. I think he used, you know, you might not have liked
him. He sold his soul and didn't win.
But
he didn't win a championship.
See, but when you look at him in the 90s and the 80s, all his players graduated. He ran a good program on all that. And then this Calipari and this one and done and all that. And I think guys like him have just ruined college basketball. You need to let those guys go to the pros. I'm with Kevin on that.
That's
if
one
you're 18,
thing.
You're good enough to go to the pros. Let them go to the pros and you're going to take
that
a lot
is
of
one
this
thing
crap
I will give Roy Williams credit for. Until this past year, when Kobe White and Nasir
says he, you know, and I saw the documentary, you know, he wants to paint himself as I'm helping these guys get to the next level. It's like, no, you're taking advantage of the situation.
Right.
That the guys have to come to college for a year.
Mm-hmm.
Young man, if you're good enough to go play pro ball at 18, why is there a rule that you can't go play pro basketball when you're 18 years old?
Right.
As far as I'm concerned, that's the way the football rules should be. If a guy is physically ready and somebody will draft him at 18 years old, then why are we holding this young
There's
man
There's only
back?
Two professions in America that we do that to. That's the football and basketball.
That's players. Crazy.
No it, other professions. It, it, soccer, it's, golf. It's
baseball,
matter,
you
what
can
it,
come out in high school.
And I'm sorry, these college programs might not be able to make it. And you know, I love college football too, but I'm just telling you that if a young man is good enough to go, let him go make his money. You know, and all these, you know, like what Saban said, well, you signed here, you owe us this month, da-da-da-da-da. It's like, why do you want to restrict kids
would
like
you
why
not,
don't they think they can buy an education after you've already made the money?
Would you not
that's
think
what I don't what get saying, like if yeah. you're going to tell me I need to get a college degree and I can make millions without the college degree, after I make my millions I got two choices. I can be like, "Hey guys, screw y'all. I made millions without a college degree because that's the job I chose."
Mm-hmm.
Or if I really want the diploma and want to get into a certain field to work in, I've got the money to pay for it.
I think this is what's going to happen when you take out the one and done deal. I think college basketball is going to get better.
It's a pro rule, not a college rule.
I know it's the NBA. It is the NBA. And Adam Silver said he's open to relooking at it as well.
I wish he would.
But it'll make college basketball better because not only that, it'll make college basketball better. It'll also make the prospects that go to college better because if they go, I don't want them to have to be for 1 year. I say it's like football, three or
I
that's
wish football
it.
Football would let you go after high school too.
And it's mostly because
some of these running backs are losing a lot of money.
If they're good enough to go, let them go.
Because in basketball, how many times do we see that one kid that had one? He says, "I'm going to go play college basketball for 1 year, and I'm going to go to the pros." He gets drafted, and what does he turn out to be? A damn bust. And then there are also those guys that have gone for 2 or 3 years, and they're always overlooked because now, this is what they'll say about them. They're old. They've got a little bit of wear and tear on them. But they'll come out there, and they're more fundamentally sound, and they know the game better than the guy that only took a pit stop there for a year. So that's why I think it'll make the prospects better, and I think it'll make college basketball better because then you don't have Calipari's and whatnot, where all of a sudden they're juggling around trying to get it to work as you go along.
Making millions of dollars at the expense of these kids.
I think it would just make college basketball a lot better if, and I feel that way about all of the college athletics. If you want to let them just go out of high school, when they go to college, they kind of got to stay for 3 years.
Don't waste a one-year
scholarship and be there for 5 to 6 months and then just say, see ya. That's just a waste.
I hate to be the guy that's going to be like that, but, you know, what you just said about, you know, it's another visual that we're going to have to look at is that if we're going to sit there and say fans can't come to games, but you're going to run out college, public high school or university college students to play the games while the coach makes $5 to $9 million, that's, to me, that's an awful, terrible optic. Let's think about what we're doing here. Mm-hmm. I mean, at the end of the day, the players, I've been told throughout history, is that they play college football for the history, the pageantry, and the love of the game, not to go pro. That's what Terry says in all those folks. So,
yeah. Please,
if that's the case, then there's no reason to be playing if there's no fans in the stands. If you're outside the top 50 on the depth chart, should those guys even be allowed to come to the stadium? I don't think so, if we're going to play. And then, again, if you're Trevor Lawrence, Tom, and you're going out on this field and there's no fans in the stands, you're not getting paid, Dabo's making $9 million, and any ankle turn, every play that you play out here with no fans and nobody watching to care about, your career could be ended and you lose $100 million. So why should Trevor Lawrence even think about playing without fans? If you don't got no fans as a college player, what does he have to prove? I think there's going to be a lot of bad optics if the NCAA starts trotting these teams after. Now, with that said, I did see a story about the Power Five conferences.
Yes.
One of the commissioners anonymously told the reporters that within the next 2 years, that the power, if with this corona, this could be an excuse for them to separate from the NCAA. The Power Fives are discussing allowing name, image, likeness, and splitting from the NCAA, which that would be all the money and everything they could. The big reason that brought this into fruition is the missing of the basketball tournament. They have so much money waiting or coming from that, is that they're like, we can't support these other schools and these other teams. Like, why are we playing them? You know, why is Alabama playing Western Carolina?
Yeah. Besides just giving away. That's only beneficial for Western because they get the money. But that's the that's only beneficial for the university. I don't think that's beneficial for the players.
Why don't Alabama play, say, Texas or somebody, and then still write $1 million check to Western Carolina to donate it?
Yeah.
if that's how you really feel. And with that said, shouldn't the teams in Alabama, and shouldn't these teams say Appalachian and Charlotte, if North Carolina and Duke and Wake Forest go out of state to play one of these sorry teams per se and pay them $1 million to play, wouldn't it be better for the North Carolina system if App or Charlotte came to North Carolina and they did pay them instead of paying another state schools? Mm-hmm. Like, wouldn't the money be better to go to South Alabama as opposed to Western Carolina?
Play somebody in state. That's
if you're going to play at a conference, play in state.
That's what Jim Tressel thought. That's why he wanted to play like an Akron, or he wanted to play like
Kent
State.
There's a ton of teams in Ohio for you guys to fill out your schedule with.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we just, you know, beat up on these little, but at least the money stays in the state.
And right.
If you're a state like Ohio, you really can't have a lot of money going out of your state because you've lost so many people over the year. You know, you haven't really been growing. So I think that's a good strategy that, you know, let's keep the money in our
state.
I'll
say this. This little investigation that they're doing, obviously with Zion, as big of a name as it is, we know it's not going to hurt Zion, except he might have to pay some money back. Other than that, he made more money than what they're asking from him right now just by signing an endorsement with
Jordan. It's going to hurt Duke.
That's what I'm saying. It's going to hurt Duke, and not only that, it has opened the door even wider for these federal investigations into every Power Five, every college program in America.
I mean, they do need to clean
it up. I know that they are investigating multiple schools at a time, but if this comes out, you're right. It hurts Duke optically very bad. It's going to be a big stain on Coach K, especially because, to me, it's because he did this and didn't even win a championship. So, like, first of all, this is painting that you're not guaranteed to win a championship. Michigan State beat him, and they did it with senior leadership. None of those guys you said were going to be a top two or three pick. They had almost one, two, and arguably could have been three on this Duke team. It opens the door wide open now to the NCAA just getting absolutely underneath a microscope for the federal.
This is where I would say it messed up. There are certain jobs you can't do unless you've got a college degree. In other words, mm-hmm. you've got a program certification. In other words, I don't want somebody operating on me who hasn't been to med school and passed the exams. I mean, I understand all that.
You won't let me get opportunity
to
do that?
No, I will not. God. But anyway, that makes sense.
It does make sense.
It does not make sense for an athlete to have to attend college or wait to a certain age. It makes no sense, like it does for other professions.
They don't do that with, like, tennis players?
Yeah. But
Tiger Woods was a
golfers. It makes no sense. So the only reason why you're doing it is you want to control the labor. Mm-hmm. So you can profit from it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
that's like my best friend Jesse Little. He's a UNC Charlotte student. But he's been able to make money driving for years.
See, to me, if there's anything a man owns, it's his labor. Mm-hmm. So if he is able to provide his labor to somebody who will purchase it. Now, like I said, there's got to be some restrictions. We can't just let any idiot open up a dentist office and call himself a dentist. Okay, man, I understand that. But if this guy has got the qualities of being a professional athlete, mm-hmm. I mean, like, I bring up Armstrong again. I think he went to Europe when he was like 18 years old to go compete. Mm-hmm. Well, but, you know, and if you're good enough at that age, why should anybody control you? Why should somebody like Nick Saban or Mike Krzyzewski control a young man's labor when he can go sell it to somebody higher?
Soccer teams do it over in Europe all the time. Soccer teams see you have any kind of talent. And they'll put you in their academy till you're 8, but that's all you do, and you're working your way up through the ranks. And then, obviously, if it's not something you want to do, you can leave at any time. Yeah. But you're there to eventually become a pro. That's exactly what it is. It's working you up to be a pro, not to just profit off of your labor.
But, I mean, to me, it's indirect stealing. You're stealing. You're making $10 million off a kid.
Look.
That's just stealing. I don't know what else to call it.
I think that's one thing I've always hated about the NCAA, and they took their foot off the gas on how hard they hit it a few years ago. Was the year when Todd Gurley and Johnny Manziel were both battling out to try and see who was going to be a Heisman winner. They suspended both of them because they were selling their autograph. And
that's the craziest.
And to me, I thought that was ridiculous because first of all, it'd be one thing if he was selling like school, like it's like a helmet, something that the school he's gotten through the school.
I don't even care if he sold a helmet. I don't even care.
Listen, that's fine for me after they've already graduated. Kind of like the Terrell Pryor situation where all of them got rid of all their Ohio State stuff.
Sold his shoes to a teammate.
Yeah.
He sold his team-issued shoes. We're giving you the shoes, Chaz. Yeah. But if you sell it to Hunter, who's on your team, you're suspended.
Now, I would have understood if he was just selling it on eBay.
But if he was, if I can't wear the damn shoes, who cares?
You're going to punish a kid for selling a pair of shoes to buy a pizza, and this guy making $10 million to coach team.
The coaches that are at stake.
I have more of an issue kind of with that when it comes to just selling team stuff. But for me, it was his damn name. That's all he has, essentially, at the end of the day, is his name, and you suspended them because they sold their name?
Like I said, I don't understand it either, Hunter.
But they're battling it right now because all these states now are passing a law where you can make money as a college athlete off your likeness. NCAA is going to either get with the times or get left behind because all these big five power schools, they're gonna jump ship. The SEC doesn't need the NCAA to pull in a couple $1 billion for football and basketball. They don't need them.
Non-profit is laughable, isn't it? Non-profit organization.
I love seeing the heads of them, and they'll be like, this guy's the head of so-and-so nonprofit. He gets paid $1.5 million a year.
What's nonprofit code for? Tax-free.
Yes, I will say this, though. I will say this. I think they got a claim on Zion. I don't think he gets out of this.
All right.
Write the check. He'll be okay. Duke's going to suffer, and when Duke suffers,
Zion will be fine.
Duke suffers, they got a claim. Fine. That's fine with me. If Mike Krzyzewski loses his job, that's fine.
Got a couple comments.
They won't do to him like they did Patino.
Probably
not. No. They'll keep him around.
A couple of comments.
Unless he leaves on his own.
From Jay Billis.
Ooh, I like Jay because
Jay's big on the paying the players thing. Here's two comments, two tweets from today. I wanted to read from him. The NCAA will never allow name, image, and likeness rights unless Congress gives the NCAA an antitrust exemption. Remember, the NCAA said name, image, likeness rights for players as long as it fits within the collegiate model. But that's like unlimited showers as long as no one gets wet. It's Billis's comp. And then the other one for today that I like, talking about you kind of lean on what you're talking about, the coaches and the money and everything. It's not really about coaches, but it's about administration. He said, there's damn good coin being made in college sports. It's not that the administrators make too much, because they don't. It's that the athletes, the well-paid administrators, work so hard to limit, are not allowed to earn or accept a nickel over their expenses, and that's just wrong. So that's the argument. Like when Terry and them, well, they get paid for room and board, and they get spaghetti, and it's like these are first of all, these are grown ass adults. They are 20 years old, 19, 20 years old, and you can throw them in jail for as an adult. So yeah, let's tell them to eat spaghetti. Now, the couple of things I wanted to get to for fun.
I like spaghetti, Kevin.
For fun, real quick. It is good, but, you know, cafeteria spaghetti for me or $1 million, Tom. Which one do you
want? Yeah, I know. I understand.
All right. Today, special announcement on our screen right now. It is McLovin's birthday.
Oh, God.
Happy birthday, McLovin, June 3rd.
Oh, God.
What?
Tom, do you understand the reference to this?
I do not.
I wanted to.
You ain't ever seen Superbad?
Ooh,
good movie. No, actually, I have not.
You love it.
It's a movie, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
These kids trying to get bioalcohol underage and go to a party.
It's so funny, man.
If basically, for folks that don't know, I guess I didn't know. I think I would have to explain McLovin. This kid got a fake ID made, and his name on it is McLovin.
From Hawaii.
From Hawaii.
He was like, check it out, bitches.
Yeah, and he's the nerdiest little kid ever. He's like, check it out.
So this is an older movie then.
2000s.
I would say mid-2000s.
It's after 2000, so that's considered old now.
So is it kind of like a Napoleon Dynamite type
thing? It's fun like that. It's fun. Okay. Well, a little bit more crude, but it's funny. Okay. It's funny.
Well, who's the fat guy in it?
Jonah Hill.
Jonah Hill's in it. Superbad was 2007.
What did I say?
With Jonah Hill. I'm pulling it up for Tom.
That movie's so funny. That movie is stupid funny.
It is a very extremely funny movie. If you get a chance to see it, I guess
I'll have to put it on my list to watch.
Put it on your list of something to watch. Yeah, I mean, it's not going to change your life or anything.
No.
It's a funny movie.
It'll give you some good references, though.
Nothing's better than McLovin. I mean, he had a fake ID to buy, and he didn't get checked once. He didn't get carded once. Everybody's like, all right, give it back to him.
Oh, God.
McLovin. All right. That gets me into the next clip I want to show.
Almost sent McLovin.
is the NCAA supposed to be taking his pictures and everything. Oh, what's going on? And then here's the gardener. It's R-Truth, baby. Rolls him up in
there. Yeah. Who
cares?
Well, I tell you what.
Damn,
I wonder, what's the over-under on how many games Gronk plays before he goes out with a concussion?
Three.
Yeah, I'd say it's not going to be much.
Here's the thing, though.
Honestly,
I thought you were
going to even need to play.
I thought you were going to ask me this. I thought you were going to ask me how many games he even plays.
I mean, I would see him on the sideline until you're losing. I wouldn't even put him in the game.
I'd make him a red zone threat.
If you're Gronk, though, have you not seen what's that disease, the brain disease called?
CTE.
CTE. Mm-hmm. Have you not seen? Why do you want to continue to do that?
Listen.
Well, he takes CBD, so he don't care.
CBD.
No, look, he everybody loves this guy.
Listen.
I mean, he shows up and does stupid stuff on New Year's Eve.
Gronkowski I'm going to say it. If he's playing right now, he's still a top five red zone threat.
But what I'm saying
is, he's rested. His body's fine.
But it ain't his body, man. It's that brain. That's got to last you a lifetime, man. Your brain's got to keep going after your body gives out. Trust me, I'm 46. I know all about that.
Oh, I'm fine. I understand. I understand every bit about it. I had three concussions of my own. I understand it. I've done all the research on it, obviously, especially whenever it was huge when they first started to talk about CT. But if that was what worried Gronk, he would have never came back to begin with.
I was saying, what are you doing?
Like, why would you give the Patriots the rights, the A-OK to just trade him unless he wanted out anyways?
They all hated Belichick. That's all it is. They wanted,
they wanted to play.
They wanted to play football and have fun.
But we're talking about the injury history of this young man, who is still, he's 29, isn't he? Or 30?
I think he's just below 30.
Man, you're young. You got money.
He's either at or just below 30.
He's kind of like Strahan, you know, because there's other avenues you have, man. You know, why are you doing this? I think he's crazy.
He's playing with his best friend.
I don't care. Who could be best friends with Tom Brady?
Rob Gronkowski.
Rob Gronkowski and Edelman cries himself to sleep every night because he's not there.
Gronk is 29. He played 13 games last year. He's only played 16 twice his first 2 years of his career.
I'm just telling you, I saw that documentary on CTE.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just tell anybody in Gronk. Like Keekly, everybody loved Keekly, but I think he made the right decision for him and his family, man. I mean, it's a
he should have retired when they wheeled him off the field crying and blood coming from his face.
Look, he got a family.
This is what they should have done.
And Keekly's got a face for TV. There's going to be other ways for him to make money. You know, you don't have to do this. I mean, if I'm a linebacker or running back or whatever, 28, 29, 30, man, you made your money. Go on with the rest of your life. And I know it's hard for him to let go when you've done the same thing ever since you were 6 years old playing Pop Warner. But I'm telling you, just watch those CTE video, the documentaries.
Yeah.
I'm like, look, you don't want to be that way, man. It's a real thing.
I don't think people understand how often people actually get concussions because they're not – people think you have to be knocked out to get a concussion, and all a concussion is a brain bruise.
See, if I do this, you go, oh, God, oh, look what happened to your leg. You can't see that on a brain.
Right.
That's what's happening to your brain.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then people don't understand that.
I can't count how many concussions I think I have, not just in football, 100. But I fell off bikes. I fell off rollerblades. I fell down stairs. I've been hitting the head with baseballs.
Calvin probably hit you a few times.
I don't know how many times I've took a charge or hit the court on a basketball court. I mean, I'm saying 100 to 200 concussions in my life I think that I know.
But every time you get hit in the head, you're considering a concussion.
I would say, according to the movie and the research, that's what it is. But what I'm going to say is that I probably remember 100 times where I've seen a light flash or I know that I've had to lay down. You hit your head. You know what it feels like when you hit your head on something? Your whole head goes numb, and you just sit there like falling off a bike or a basketball court.
I got hit in the head playing soccer one time, and it made me black out. Like, I didn't know where I was. And when I came to, I was on the bench. And I thought maybe I had just, you know, fallen asleep just sitting there on the bench, and the game was over. We'd only played 5 minutes, and I'd been out for like 10. And it's crazy because my mom said I was still talking, but it's one of those things where it's like your subconscious just takes over, and you have no idea what's happening, and then you finally come to, and you're like,
I want to say soccer.
What the hell?
Soccer is number two behind football and concussions.
Well, it is because we go up for headers.
Yeah,
it's like what we do.
Any contact to the brain, hitting the inside of your skull is a concussion.
And when they teach you to head the ball, they obviously want you to use the, like, not exactly your forehead, but right at the crown between, kind of like where you would wear your hat, your hairline. You don't want to hit it up top, and you never want to try, but they do it anyways, obviously, to try and get it to where they want it to go. When they flick their neck, hit it on your temple. If you hit yourself in the temple, if it hits it just right, you're out. And the problem that comes with soccer as well is just like in football. You're hitting heads in football. If you're going up as an offensive player and a defensive player is going up as well, look, man, that defensive player can't just go out there and hit it with his hand unless he's a goalie. But even then, I have seen a number of times where our offensive player is going up for a ball coming off of a corner kick. The goalie's got just as much of a right to run out there and try and hit that ball and grab it with his hand. Clocks him right in the temple, knocked him out for the rest of the game. I've seen it happen twice. So it's just one of the, like, it doesn't surprise me that soccer's up there for concussions. I've had three, and they all were due to it.
Should the soccer players be wearing
Little hats.
Little cushioned hats. I'm not asking
it's
if it's jack
it's
wagon.
No.
It's
legal.
I'm saying,
it is
should
legal.
Should they be?
It is legal. Should they?
Probably.
Yeah, probably. Probably. Football players especially, will wear it underneath their football helmets.
Especially underage. Let me say that.
Yes.
If you're under 18.
Yes. What there, they say, the brain takes until at least 20.
It's about 21. At least, probably.
Yeah, to yeah. even. So, absolutely. And I know you weren't meaning that as a jackwagon.
Right.
Because even for me, I would look at you and say, are you serious? Like, this is, it's goofy. But if you know, if you're a parent and you're thinking about it as your kid, like, that's all you can do. You can either hit the ball with your foot, your lower leg. If you hit it right on your shoulder, it's not going to be considered a handball. It's anything from here down. You can hit it here with your
they
shoulder
already
and your chest.
Wear sports bras. I think they can go to the
well, yeah, they to, the to track things. Them. Yeah, they use it.
Have you seen those, Tom?
They use them to track how far that, how long they run and stuff.
Yeah, they've got.
But I know I've seen some. They put them in the cleats, so that's a little bit better. I think it should be mandatory in football and soccer. Because basketball, you don't really get hit in the head much. You can, yeah. but most of the time it's a flagrant.
Or accidental
elbows.
Are the worst
yeah, that's what I'm saying. Just, I don't think it would hurt. I don't think it would hurt. If you can just get past the, oh, it looks goofy, I think you're fine.
NFL teams used to wear leather helmets, so
yeah.
soccer players get over it.
Well, we've not worn any helmets.
Wrestlers wear the ear covers, so yeah. those are pretty
you
tough sports.
You wouldn't be able to head it as far, but, you know. It's funny you mentioned that the wrestling. I knew a guy who wanted a John Wayne, didn't wear one. Mm-hmm. I worked with him at the truck company. His ears were completely disfigured.
Mm-hmm. Just cauliflower ear.
And he goes, well, it's a good conversation piece. I'm like, buddy.
It's a good conversation piece.
Buddy.
What's can
the
you
second
hear?
Part of
can
you're
you
an
hear?
Idiot.
Fine, but.
I got the second conversation piece. How stupid you are.
Sir, can you even hear?
We can talk about all kinds of things. One, your dumbass ears. Two, you're an idiot.
Right.
For thinking that's a good thing. And a conversation starter. Shit.
that was a long time ago. Of course, it was my blue collar days, the trucking company. So I guess you kind of run into different clientele than you do in,
I'm sure that.
In radio and teaching.
Well, speaking of teaching and trucking companies, Tom, my wife and I went, you know, this weekend out of town for an anniversary. Well, she had to have a meeting on the way to where we were going. So I ate Dairy Queen ice cream while she had a meeting with some parents at a truck stop parking lot. And she was all concerned about it. And I said, honey, this is probably ranks on the list of 1 millionth weirdest thing that has ever happened in a truck stop parking lot.
I slept at a truck lot one time when I was in a car. I had a buddy who lived in Pensacola,
mm-hmm.
and I got off. I worked at the trucking company then. I got off at midnight. And I'm like, yeah, man, I just work 9-hour shift. I'm going to get in the car. I'm going to drive to Pensacola. I'll be there by morning. Well, I made it to Montgomery, Alabama, and stopped there. And got in between, got a little Cavaliers, all these trucks, and in my little car there. So I just slept away. I did stuff like that when I was 23.
It's one of the police that knock on your door thinking you was dealing with a truck or stuff being parked out.
Right.
Then that was back in the days where you had to have a road map.
So yes.
I went in, and I'm like, I need a road map to see how to get there. And there was some old lady working there, and she was just telling the story. Yeah, they better not come to my house. I know what she was talking about. She goes, they better know. They better know I'm ready for them. My gun's loaded. I'll blow your ass out the front door. Can I help you, sir? I'm like, you know, you get the Alabama stereotypes, but some of them are true.
Can I help you?
Can I help you,
as soon as she
got
done, can I help you, sir? I said, I just want a roadmap, ma'am.
I just don't want to piss you off like that last guy. What do I need to say? You need a hug, a kiss.
Yes,
what you need, baby.
Yes,
girl.
But that was in my younger days where you would do stupid stuff like that when you're young. You just hop in the car, and I remember I ran into some guys out at the club. Hey, man, we're going to Hilton Head tomorrow. Sure, I'm going. Man, just hop in the car and go in the middle of the night. I mean, it's been a long time.
I rode to Orlando in high school one weekend.
Yeah, you know, just
so
went
one of here. One of my teammates' brothers was in actually flight school. In Orlando to be he's a commercial airline pilot for American Airlines now. We just decided to drive down there and see him. Now, that was a very – some things I could tell you about that trip, and the others I probably couldn't, but that kid was weird. Yeah, he's a fun, random, weird guy to go do that with. We did get to drive. I'll tell you one thing cool about that trip. We drove my car on Daytona Beach.
I've done that one.
So it's during the winter where you can and you can take your cars out. So
it was pretty fun.
Wanted to drive my 4Runner out on the beach like we were Dale Earnhardt.
There you go.
It wasn't Dale Earnhardt. It was Rich Lee Petty back in the day.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen photos of the track on the beach that NASCAR used to race?
I probably
have not. Those are some amazing pics. And kind of what I'm getting to now is NASCAR returns to Nashville next year in 2021. The owner is Dover Motorsports. The 1.3-mile oval opened in 2001 and hosted several Xfinity and Truck Series through 2011. When it ceased operations after failing to secure a Cup Series race, news of the reopening comes after Nashville hosted NASCAR Champions Weeks last December with a great success. After the awards banquet, NASCAR says, we want to get back here. NASCAR to Nashville again. The company built the track and also owns Dover, which will give up one of its races to accommodate the Nashville event. So the Monster Mile in Dover will be losing a track event, and Nashville will be getting it. I don't know if I like that, losing the Dovers, because the Dover Monster Miles are really good races. I do like getting back and expanding. If you're going to expand and expand, you know, back into the South.
Yeah. I think that's where I would have went with it. I think I could sit here and say it, you know, I'm okay with a maybe a losing a northern race and bringing it back to being regional. And especially,
do you need to go to Dover twice, I guess?
No, yeah, you don't need to go to Dover twice. But not only that,
Tom, you want to go to Delaware twice a year?
It's
especially if you're making $1 million.
Say it with me. It's Nashville.
Nashville. I know.
It's Nashville.
Nothing's better than Nashville.
No, I'm telling you, if you've not been to Nashville and you're a listener, you have not experienced why they call it Nash Vegas. Okay, it is so much fun. You've already got everybody there and their brother that's trying to get rowdy on a summer night, and you're asking that crowd to then mix with a NASCAR crowd. It's just going to be one big tailgate all throughout Nashville.
Next year.
How old's the track?
That one that they're racing on, 2001, it said it was built. They've got two tracks. One is at the fairgrounds. And they've been in, it says right here, they've been in discussions to get the track back there and racing there at the fairgrounds, but the track wouldn't be ready for this year.
That probably goes way back,
though. Right. They haven't raced since 1984 at that place. So that's been 30 years.
I'll say this about that. That would host a fair and then have NASCAR happening later that night.
Fairgrounds.
NASCAR, give me a call. I got a bunch of ideas how we can make you a bunch of money. Listen, bunch of money.
That's getting something else. NASCAR, if you're listening, yeah. Call
NASCAR,
Hunter.
If you're listening.
We have a new business consultant.
I'm just saying. But I come at it from a business standpoint.
What I agree with y'all is the Carolinas, Virginia, Tennessee, Georgia, Florida.
Bring
Alabama.
It back to the moonshine running roots.
That's where it all ought to be anyway. I mean, I guess when they, like, you know, one thing I don't agree with Terry on much sometimes, but like Watkins Glen, really? Sonoma, California? You know,
it's one thing going
Michigan.
To California for a super speedway race, I guess, but the road courses, you know, the road courses aren't, to me, I've never liked watching them. There's too many variables and winning. However, I'm sure they're fun as hell to drive. They have to be for the drivers.
Well, they used to get, it seemed like when I used to keep up a little bit more, like for road races, some teams would bring in a guy who was like an Indy driver bring him in for that
race. If you're not in the top like 15 and 20 points,
the smaller cars,
operations will do that. Boris said, Robbie Gordon.
Yeah.
There are track specialists.
Whatever happened to Robbie Gordon?
Old.
Young, boy, he was Mr. Hotshot. I remember when he
Jimmy
was young.
Jimmy Johnson's retired this year, Tom. They're all getting old.
No, but I'm saying I don't remember him even really being relevant for a long, long time. Like in the mid-90s, he was kind of up and coming, kind of like Jeff Gordon, who was kind of a – there was no relation. But, no. I mean, he was kind of an up-and-coming rising star. And it's like, man, I hadn't heard that name Robbie Gordon in a long time.
Sometimes you get there and the stage gets too big. Lights get too
big.
At the
I had a friend who was a Ward Burton fan.
A Ward Burton fan.
How about that name? Hadn't heard that one in a long time.
Do you still have that friend?
Oh, yeah, he's a friend. Well, I haven't talked to him in a long time.
I was just wondering if it was like a local, like somebody that still lived around here type thing.
No, he was from Alexander County.
Okay. because I have a Ward Burton starting lineup down the hall.
Do you really?
Yes.
Wow. Ward Burton.
I got a Jeff Gordon, a Ward Burton. I can't remember the other one. I got three of them. The two of them aren't any good, but the Jeff Gordon one is pretty good. Yeah, so coming back to Nashville, they've never had a NASCAR race there since actual Cup Series since 84. The Xfinity and trucks have ran at this track. So to come back to the city but not the fairgrounds, take what you can get, I guess, if you're NASCAR fans. But that should be fun, and I'm excited about that this weekend.
When are they coming back to North Wilkesboro? That's what I want.
Never. Probably not.
Rockingham. When are they coming back to Rockingham?
Now, there's a lot better chance for that. There's a good chance for that. That track is ready to race. They still do
Martinsville, race. Though, right?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Martinsville's actually this week or next week. I was just trying to pull up and figure out.
And they
out.
Still do Richmond, the short track races.
Yes. So this week they'll be in Atlanta on Sunday, Martinsville on Wednesday.
Atlanta's very similar to Charlotte, right?
And then back to Miami on next Sunday. Now, Atlanta is probably the flattest.
It's a little flatter than Charlotte.
I've got you guys running on your sim here in Atlanta. It's probably the flattest, easiest track to drive and not hit the wall in.
Nice.
And then Tom hit it in turn one.
yeah, I don't play that game.
But
it's okay, Tom. You just need to know how to drive.
Is it
take a left?
But you compare like the tracks that kind of pop into my mind that are similar: Charlotte, Atlanta, Texas Motor Speedway is probably similar, about that mile and a half.
Yeah, on the mile and a half. So yeah. the same company owns a lot of them.
Another one. It's about a mile and a half. I know those three. What's Michigan?
That's I think it might be two.
I think it's about a mile and a half to Walmart up the road. Does that count?
What are you talking about? We're talking about racetrack.
Atlanta's a mile and a half.
I'm making a joke, Tom.
Come on, you got to work on your punchline.
I'll go down the list for you. Atlanta's a mile and a half. We're here.
All right, Tom, be more professional. Ding,
the
ding,
professional.
The biggest is Talladega at 2.6 miles. Watkins Glen is second at 2.4 miles. Yeah, Charlotte's Roval is third at 2.3 miles. I don't know why that's listed as third when Daytona is 2.5. Indy is 2.5. Wow, yeah. Put that at third. Somebody put the list wrong.
Is Indy really that long?
Indy's 2.5 miles. Pocono's 2.5.
Yeah, Pocono's long.
California's 2. Michigan's 2. Sonoma's 2. And then Atlanta, Darlington, Charlotte, Chicago, Miami, Kansas, Chicago. Kentucky.
You're really racing NASCAR in Chicago.
Vegas, Texas.
Crazy.
Those are all mile and a half. Chicago lost one of their races this year. That's one of the ones I think they took.
Good.
Bristol's a half a mile, Martinsville half a mile, and Richmond 0.7 miles.
I kind of like the short track. I think when I was younger, I liked the bigger tracks because they go faster. But I think that I like that Bristol race, listening to it, it's pretty exciting. When they're not got red flag and have to clean up all the mess because everybody wrecks. But live racing's fun on a short track.
Anytime the leaders, the top, anytime you're at a track, the top six can win on a restart, after a restart, that's your good tracks. That's your good places, because then it's still competitive to the end of the race.
Yeah.
You get in some spaces, it's just Charlotte just isn't that way. Yeah, the Roval has been, to me, way more competitive and exciting.
Is that the fall race?
Yes, one that where they do the road course and mixed with the big track. That's been way more. It's only been 2 years, and that's been way more exciting than any almost Charlotte race I've ever seen. The All-Star race has been exciting in the past before, especially when the $1 million meant something more than it does now to the guys. But there was the All-Star race has been competitive. The 600 has not been in the 500 in the past. But all right, so Sunday again we'll be going to Folds of Honor Quick Trip 500 in Atlanta.
It's on WCSL.
As always. Now, starting in about 2 weeks, they'll be switching over to NBC on the TV from Fox. So June 27th will be the first NBC race of the year. And they'll be going from there. Pocono has a Saturday and a Sunday race this year, back-to-back, so they don't travel up there twice. Any other news and notes, fellas?
I think that's it for me.
Suggestions.
I think we're good.
Let me go. I had another note or two here real quick I wanted to get to. I think I had some fun with our motorcycles.
Mm-hmm.
We talked Gronk 24/7. We talked this and that.
Yeah, we talked that. Yep.
Hulk Hogan's wife banned for life from wrestling. Did you hear that one?
No. What does she have to do with wrestling? What did she do?
Well, she said
that. She said something bad about somebody.
She said that all the rioters were a bunch of Afro-Americans and blah, blah, blah. And she crossed the line. Mm. If you read the tweet, she crossed his ex-wife. Because, you know, Hulk Hogan got banned for comments and then he was invited back. But, yeah, she did something stupid. If you're going to say something stupid, don't put it on Twitter, sweetheart. So now you're banned from wrestling events. So that you might want to read up on that. But it just goes to show you, man, why don't people think about what they say before they say it? It's just unbelievable.
This is a satire site. I just wanted to read the headline just for a fun laugh. But God forbid in today's society you can't laugh at anything, but we're going to try. Clever churchgoers are avoiding arrest by the government by disguising themselves as rioters. That's what they're doing on Sundays. Like I said, that was a satire fact. Tom, do you believe in astrology?
I do not.
Well, here's fun facts about astrology, even if you don't believe in it. Hunter, mm-hmm. You believe in astrology?
No, I really don't. I think I know my sign, but that's about it.
The last time Saturn was in Aquarius was during the Rodney King riots. The last time Pluto was in Capricorn was during the American Revolution. And the last time Neptune was in Pisces was the fall of Rome. Right now we have all three.
What the hell?
that's what I was probably waiting on.
What the hell?
Means absolutely. I would like to go out and see it, but
see what?
Neptune and Pisces. Just can you see Neptune with the naked eye?
Does that? I don't know.
What is that?
I don't know.
Probably, you can probably get like a telescope. Maybe.
I don't think
is it strong
Neptune
enough?
I'm not sure.
I don't know.
Can you see Saturn with a naked
eye? All you listeners, that was your what the hell moment of the day.
I do know you can see Saturn at sometimes with the naked eye.
With the naked eye?
I think I do know that. That is one of Saturn is one of the is actually the main planet that the ancients worshipped more than the rest of them. Saturn, according to some of the ancient scripts, was worshipped as our second sun. And some believe that Saturn, scientists, historians included, believe that Saturn might have actually been closer at some point. And according to some of the ancient stories, that Saturn was moved out by something else. And that's part of, you know, we've got the asteroid belt, and it seems like there's a missing planet. According to some of the ancient Sumerian writings, that has something to do with that. So Saturn does play a very important part in the night sky. Saturn is also...
aliens.
Saturn is the main planet of worship for the occult. So it's tied into Satanism and other things. So yes, Tom, Saturn is very much visible at night. Especially when it's closer in orbit. So there you learn.
It's been
a while
since
Saturn
I had
today.
Sophomore astrology.
Yeah,
so.
That's fun. I love astrology.
Learn something new every day.
Learn something.
Or you relearn
astrology,
something.
Astrology, history. Yeah. We can talk sports. Talk about a little bit of everything.
We're a Swiss Army knife.
Don't talk history with Kevin. don't even try it.
Listen, everyone has different perspectives, Tom.
Yeah.
Now, so Saturday, Mitchum's Kitchen Sports Talk.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, we may have an NBA thing. Actual
should
deal,
be set in stone by tomorrow afternoon.
Actual deal
hopefully.
To talk about.
That'd be good.
Then
race until Sunday.
We've got some NASCAR predictions on Saturday to go over with Terry in Atlanta. Look towards whoever.
Are they going to qualify this week since they have the whole week?
I do not know the answers on that one. The way they're trying to do qualifying is that the days when they first started this, they said that. That they weren't going to do any qualifying except the 600, and they was going to do everything off honors points. So I'm going to say they're going with that. I'll have a true answer for you. How about that Saturday? Tom?
Okay. Good deal.
All right, Hunter, any questions, comments, concerns before we get out of here?
No, I think everybody just needs to have a Great rest of their day.
And just say one service message that if you need information about graduation, it's coming out. Burns kids need to go Monday to pick up their information about graduation. So if you know somebody, and if you need to call the school and get some or email Roxanne Parker.
All right, folks, we'll see you Saturday on Saturday Morning Sports Talk. Mitchum Kitchen Breakfast. Terry Reinhardt will join us. We'll have some food and more. We'll see you next time on Shock Jocks and KDC Broadcasting.com. The incredible man, I only do things incredible can, because I am the seed of a chosen breed. You don't see.